You can really use any kind of potato for mashed potatoes. I like Yukon Golds. It makes a creamy mashed potato, but you can also use a good old russet potato for something a little fluffier. This really helps season the potatoes, and then you don't have to add as much salt later. That'll come back to the boil. It'll cook about 10 to 20 minutes. For about 3 pounds of potatoes, I use about a half a cup of milk and 6 tablespoons of butter, and it's melting over medium heat. No resistance. I pull back the skewer, it comes right back. Yeah, and that's great. And I just want to dry them out. And what that does is it makes them extra fluffy and creamy because they're able to absorb the liquid that I put in them without watering it down. A ricer gives the potatoes a really beautiful, smooth fluffiness. And then really all I need to do is add this butter-milk combination. It smells so good. And all you have to do is stir. And those are the perfect mashed potatoes.
If you're having a lot of people and you're worried about cooking 2 big birds, I have a suggestion. Why don't you make 1 bird, but days ahead even, you could do a turkey breast. You could stuff a turkey breast. What I have here is a bone-in turkey breast, 7 or 8 pounds. It comes with one of these things, which you're going to take out right away. What I have done is I've lined my counter with plastic wrap, a couple of pieces, and that way I'm not going to get any turkey anywhere I don't want it to be. And my breastbone. I'm going to start making a cut, and I want to try to keep the skin together with the flesh. I am going to make some cuts. You'll see it's falling right away very nicely. And that's about as far as I want to go on this side. I haven't left too much meat on the bone, and I see that turkey tenderloin. And then I'm just going to sort of cut it away. So these are my turkey tenderloins. So what could I do with those? I could save them for sandwiches or stir fries. I want to get it free at this point from the bone. What this carcass can do is I can do 2 things. I can throw it in the oven with some herbs and spices, and I can roast it and use it for stock, or I can put it in a stock pot right now with some aromatics. And we are out. I want to get kind of a flat surface, so I might make a few shallow cuts. I cut a slice of this, and then I'll have a nice slice to make a sandwich with that's got the stuffing. All you need to do is add the cranberry sauce. I've got everything I need here to make Pam the Butcher's roast turkey au jus. I have some herbs and an onion that's quartered for stuffing the turkey. I've got a mixture of salt, pepper, garlic powder, and dried sage. I've got water, celery, and about a 14-pound bird. It trusses the bird. It keeps the legs in so that the bird cooks nice and evenly. And you'll notice I don't have a rack there because we're going to be building a rack with the celery. Alrighty, I'm putting my bird on the celery rack. And then I'm gonna season inside the cavity. Now I'm gonna fill the cavity with a nice mixture of herbs. I'm going to add the onion. They don't really need to be very tightly packed in there. Now I'm gonna season the outside of the bird with some of the spice mixture, kind of nice and evenly. The last thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna pour enough water just to cover the celery. Into the oven, Big Bird goes. It should really be in the middle of the oven, but depending on how tall your bird is, how big the breastbone is, you may need to drop that middle rack just down one peg. And for the next 2 hours, I'm gonna be basting a total of 3 times with the mixture, the liquid, that's mingling with the spices and the juices from the turkey. I'm gonna be basting with that liquid inside the bird, inside the cavity, as well as on the bird's exterior. After the last baste, after maybe 10 minutes, I'm gonna tip that bird just a little bit so that I get as much broth and liquid and juices out of the cavity at that point as I can. I'm looking for an internal temperature of 160 degrees. I'm gonna pull this bird out. I'm gonna let it sit for at least 15 or 20 minutes before I carve it up.
Don't worry about matching one wine to everything. Nothing's going to match all the turkey and the trimmings and, God forbid, the jellied cranberry sauce. Champagne or sparkling wine is the ultimate palate cleanser. The bubbles refresh your mouth and get you ready for the next bite. Try cider as your bubbly. Cider, of course, is traditional from colonial times. They're lower in alcohol, very refreshing. Pinot Noir is a Thanksgiving favorite, no matter where it's from. Try a fruity white, maybe a little bit off dry. A little bit of sweetness helps with the variety of flavors. For that big, bold red with the roast turkey, I favor this Maryland Syrah from Black Ankle. When you get towards dessert, if you're having cheese or pumpkin pie, look for something sweeter. The wine should be sweeter than the dessert, generally. We have Petit Manseng from Virginia, which is great with cheeses, very fruity, very aromatic. And here's a late harvest Vinsanto style from Virginia that's just wonderful with pumpkin pie. Enjoy the feast, don't sweat the wine, just open one of everything.
Frying is a great technique for cooking all sorts of foods, but people are afraid of it. It's greasy, it's messy, but it doesn't have to be either of those things if you follow a few simple rules. I'm going to show you some tricks. So I like to use a vegetable oil, a neutral vegetable oil, like sunflower oil or safflower oil. So the key is to make sure that the oil gets up to 375 degrees. That way the food will crisp without absorbing it. So I thought we would try one of my favorite things of the season, fried green tomatoes. They're coated in a little panko flakes. Don't be afraid to get a little close to the oil when you drop them in, because that way it won't splatter. Make sure that you don't put in so many items that there's not room for the oil to bubble all the way around. So the great thing about frying is that if the oil is at the right temperature, you can tell when the crust is browned, the food should be cooked. Because this keeps it extra crisp. You want the oil to have cooled. It doesn't have to be completely room temperature, but it shouldn't be scalding hot anymore. And you want to use a wide mouth funnel and a coffee filter. Put it on a mason jar, and then it's going to slowly drip through, and it's going to leave all those little bits in the filter.
I'm here with Ellie Krieger. She's a nutritionist. She's hosted shows on the Food Network, and now she's been sharing her healthful recipes with us in the Nourish column in the Washington Post food section.
Hi, Ellie. Great to be here, Bonnie.
So you are making a really cool cauliflower dish.
Yes, my favorite new way to cook cauliflower is to make it into rice. So I'm doing this great rice pilaf kind of dish with cauliflower. I'll show you how to do it.
All right.
I'm going to cut it into three or four kind of large chunks, leaving as much stem attached as possible. And then you just whip out your handy dandy box grater on the wide grater part, and you just grate away. And you just basically grate it until you get to the stem, so you don't grate up the stems. So just like this until you get to 4 cups. All right, and when it's all said and done, you have this beautiful cauliflower rice. Now I'm just gonna cook it up with some amazingly delicious spices. So one of the spices I'm using is saffron. So just a generous pinch of saffron. I'm just going to kind of dissolve that a little bit. It won't dissolve fully, of course, but the water will get color and flavor, and we'll pour that whole thing into the dish once it's cooking. All right, off to the stove. So just starting off heating up about a tablespoon of olive oil, and I'm going to toast the cumin seeds, about a teaspoon of cumin seeds. And basically you just want to toast them for about 30 seconds once the pan gets really cooking there, just until they become super fragrant. Now I'm just gonna put in the cauliflower rice. Toss that around and really just cook it until it's tender. Doesn't take very long at all because it's such small pieces, maybe 2 minutes. This is really delicious with like a tandoori chicken on the side, or even really any kind of roasted meat or grilled meat. And I also love it with a stew. All right, so now just the saffron, which will give it this beautiful golden hue. And then just a little salt, 1/4 teaspoon, not much at all. There you have it, a beautiful bowl of cumin, saffron, cauliflower rice. Hey, Bonnie, come try this.
All right.
I think you're gonna love it.
It smells great.
Should we try it together?
Sure.
I'm going spoon, I'm going fork. See, it can go either way.
That's very tasty.
I'm glad you like it.
Tell me a little bit about your philosophy of cooking.
So you know I'm a professional nutritionist.
I do.
Okay? But I am a food lover first at my very, very core. And really, I think that very often in our culture, we feel like we have to sacrifice taste in order to be healthy, and vice versa. We have to sacrifice health if we want something really good. And it's not true. My whole thing is about finding that sweet spot where delicious and healthy meet. And it's important to me personally, because that's the food I want, and also professionally.
Thanks so much for coming.
Great to be here. Thank you.
It's fall, which means it's winter squash season. They can be a little hard to prep. I'm going to show you 4 tips for how to do it better. Winter squash are hard. They're not so hard that you can't peel them if you have a really nice sharp peeler, but here's a way to make peeling a little bit easier. Cut a few little slits, then I'm going to microwave it. Beautifully peeled squash. I like to cut it crosswise, right where it starts to become bulbous, because this is where the seeds are. There's your seeds. So to get the seeds out, I either like to use a spoon or an ice cream scoop. An ice cream scoop is about just the right size to do this. So that's ready to cut up. So to cube the squash, the first thing you want to make sure you do is to create as flat of a surface as possible for safety purposes. So I cut the end off, and then I cut lengthwise down, and now I've got this nice, easy piece to work with. So you can just cut it lengthwise, come across for your cubes. And then with the rounded edge, you're going to do the same thing. So acorn squash is a little bit trickier because of all the ridges, which makes it harder to peel. Here's the way I like to do it. First, cut off an end. Cut it in half lengthwise, cutting in the middle of one of those ridges. Now you can certainly take the seeds out. And then when you cut the squash, cut it along the ridges. So I'm going in the deep part of the ridge. Now, what you can do is peel just this part.
Candy corn. Yellow, white, and orange. More than 35 million pounds are produced each year. That's like 9 billion pieces of corn. So who eats this stuff? Is it you? Who makes this stuff? Is it them? We went to Waukegan, Illinois. Folks have been making this candy for more than 100 years. Maybe they can show us how to get those 3 colors into that tiny piece of corn. It all starts in the kitchen. With a gooey mixture of sugar and corn syrup, which is basically just more sugar. The mixture is split into 3 different kettles, where a candy maker pours food coloring and flavoring into each of the bins, blended together into a buttery vanilla cream. When the mix is complete, the candy cream oozes into the floor below. The molds are filled layer by layer. The white vanilla cream goes first, but you don't need a lot of it since it's just the tip. Up next is orange, and then yellow.
In the spectrum of food processing, candy is at the upper end of the complexity of manufacturing. It's vastly different than it was many years ago when it was all done by hand.
It usually takes a day or two for the candy to harden, and then the workers run it through the mogul again, this time shaking it up so all the candy comes loose. Workers inspect the product to filter out any funny-looking pieces, but they aren't allowed to taste it, unless, of course, it's for quality control. Now it's time to polish things up. The corn is placed into pans that look like tiny cement mixers. They polish it off with some beeswax and a confectioner's glaze that can give off a pretty potent smell if you get too close.
There's a little bit of an art to making candy corn and making it correctly. It's simple yet complicated.
Now the candy is ready for delivery. The busiest month for candy corn production is actually in July, to get into stores before the Halloween rush. The candy travels from the Jelly Belly facility to a wonderful place called Pleasant Prairie, Wisconsin. This batch made the trip to Alexandria, Virginia. Here, sisters Alyssa and Kim Theodore co-own a shop called The Sugar Cube. They sell candy corn year-round.
I'm not a nibbler. Throw the whole thing in your mouth.
I eat the bottom.
Yeah, you're a tail.
Yeah, I'm a tail.
It's the plump part.
But inevitably, the candy corn ends up in the hands of John Beachman, a man who's loved candy corn since he was a child.
I break the rules at least once a year and chow down on a few kernels of candy corn.
The life cycle of a candy corn.
Delicious. Care for one?
I knew that I wanted to do a cold dish with farro. It's really one of those like really quintessential Italian ingredients that when we were putting together the menu here, I wanted to feature. I decided to use hazelnuts, which is also a very quintessential Italian ingredient. And then, you know, I wanted some sweetness in the dish to go with the nuttiness, and that's where the beets came in. The last element was the fennel. Shaved raw fennel, to me, is always a really wonderful, crunchy, fresh flavor with that slightly sort of anise flavor profile. It's sweet, it's salty, it's nutty, it's fresh, it's crisp. It hits all those sort of notes that I sort of am looking for when I'm creating a dish.
A lot of ingredients go into the making of crazy Doritos, or Dory Locos as they're known here in Mexico. After cutting open the bag of chips, Evelia Alcala adds shredded carrots, and then jicama. Next, she adds some diced cucumber. And then a heaping portion of pickled pork rinds. Alcala assures these are quite popular. Peanuts go on top of those. And then swirls of fruity chamoy sauce, is followed by two kinds of chili powder. After that, Alcala adds mildly spicy Valentina hot sauce. At this point, the bag is getting heavy. She slices open a lime and squeezes it out into the bag. But she's still not finished. Those are sweet gummy candies coated in another kind of chili powder. She inserts a tamarindo candy, then tops the whole thing with her secret sauce, a spicy and sugary blend of fruity syrup and chili powder. Stick a fork in it. The whole concoction costs 18 pesos, or about $1.50. Alcala calls her version Dorilocos with a smile.
Wanted to do something with butternut squash in a kind of a salad format. I thought texture-wise that it would be nicer to have like thin things instead of big blocks. Be like pasta, like it's al dente. It was just a process of probably form follows function. It's about how it like kind of feels in your mouth. It's like a crunchy cloud.
Attention beer lovers, we're about to save you the trauma of losing any more brews to skunking. It's a miserable feeling when you've cracked open a cold one on a beautiful sunny day, only to take a sip and find out that it tastes and smells like a skunk's behind. So what the heck happened to your once delicious beer, and how can you stop that from happening again? Skunking is a photochemical reaction. This means that light is causing things to go down deep inside your beer at the molecular level. To understand the skunking reaction, you've got to get a sense of the chemical makeup of your beer, and in particular, the things that give beer their distinct flavors. Hops and barley. These are the two main ingredients that give beer its flavor, but when talking skunks, the culprit is the hops. During the brewing process, hops are boiled down and release bitter flavor compounds known as isoalpha acids. These isoalpha acids, when hit with sunlight, break down into free radicals that get mixed up with proteins that have sulfur in them. That reaction creates this putrid molecule, which is almost indistinguishable from the stuff in a skunk's behind. The worst part is that it's insanely potent. People can detect this stuff when in concentrations as low as one part per billion. So in other words, if you fill an Olympic-sized swimming pool with beer, one eyedropper of this stuff would change the way it tasted. A skunk beer is also known as a light-struck beer. Dramatic, right? So the best tip, get rid of the light to get rid of the skunk. Draft beers in glass bottles should be kept in the shade as much as possible. If you notice, a lot of craft brews come in either aluminum cans or brown bottles. These two containers do the best at keeping light out of the picture. But even brown glass can let in enough light over time to skunk your beer, so keep that cooler lid shut. Some people say that you have to keep your beers out of the heat to stop them from being skunked. Well, it's time to debunk that myth. Heat and temperature changes don't skunk beers. Instead, heat increases the rate of oxidation in the beer, which in turn can make your beer taste really stale or like cardboard. That doesn't mean it's skunked. But even if it isn't skunked, no one out there wants to drink a hot, stale beer anyways. So stick to the shade and watch out where you store your favorite beers if you want to keep them tasting good. If you're interested in learning a quick trick to cool your beers super fast, check out Volume 3 of our Chemistry Life Hack series, and then check out how breathalyzers work in this video. So look, folks, I don't need to tell you, but I'm going to anyways. Always drink responsibly. And don't forget to subscribe to our channel and stay tuned every Monday for new videos.
The arepa started indigenous in Venezuela. It changed with the colonization of the Spaniards when they came in. They started mixing ingredients into it. They started cutting it in half. It was used as a fork. It was used as your guide. You cook your arepa, you grab it, and you eat with it. Regular arepas are normally bigger, so you have them as a lunch, as a meal, like on the go. Our arepas are more of a sharing size, and each of our little arepas is compact with so much flavor that you really don't want to cut it and give it away, so you just want to take it and eat it yourself.
I think for me, it's not just philosophy, I think it's kind of grew in. It's nature, it's second nature for me. It's inspiration of the day. So philosophy, I'm like, yeah, you can think about it, you can talk about it. Food, yeah, it keeps on going. It runs in my blood, so. Background, so yeah, originally from Belgium. Grew up in the restaurant business between the pots and the pans. I went to cooking school at the age of 12 until 18. Worked a little bit in Belgium. After that, I kind of decided I wanted to do something different and I got the chance to come to the US. My parents, my grandparents were in the food business also, so one of my grandparents had a food store and a small slaughterhouse for small animals. Animals and vegetables and herbs and all that kind of stuff grow with me. So I'm used to go in the backyard and pick up something and cook it.
To be in the backyard, kind of like being away, a little bit of relaxation of everything and don't have to worry directly about everything in the kitchens. But at the same time, I'm still working for the kitchen.
The moment you open your own place, it ain't just anymore about cooking. It is about the design. It's about the silverware. It's about the service. It becomes your own. And then on the backside of that also, that you actually make money and be capable of paying all the bills. So all that stress who comes with it, when you open, I would say that's like 2 years of crazy stress.
I don't think the blue one will work either.
And it's day and night. When I was opening Belga, I kind of started as a chef. And I was like, yeah, I'm the owner now. And I was cooking every day from morning till evening. And in between I would do invoices and this and that. And then so little by little, you have people around you who are growing with you and who kind of take tasks from you away. And that's kind of like the growth that you have. I mean, like you become a person who has to spend more time in the office.
Do you know where the wines are?
I do miss the kitchen. I definitely do miss the kitchen. But yeah, two restaurants, I still feel it's my kitchen. The base is still my cooking. The creative part is still there, but the cooking part is a little bit gone. Do I miss it? Absolutely. But yeah, it's also part of the fun. When I worked at other restaurants, you constantly move, and every 2 years you move from one place to the other. But here it became home. So if I was in Belgium and they said like, oh, you're gonna go home, they thought I wanna go to my mom. I'm like, no, I'm going home. Like, yeah, but don't you just live in the US? Like, no, that's my home. So do we want to do other restaurants? I think probably.
Chipotle model, as I understand it, is really you know, great fresh ingredients, cooking them right in front of customers in an open kitchen, and serving it to them in a customizable format. So it was very natural to take the Chipotle model and apply it to Southeast Asian cuisine because that model really exists over there in these shop houses. The reason that works so well is because guests get to choose exactly what they want.
Somehow when you walk into a place and there are, you know, 25 options for what you could get in your rice bowl, and you feel like, it feels like plentiful to you, it feels good. And many of these restaurants even use choice in the way they appeal to customers.
I just think this format and the healthy component to it,
the quick component to it and the affordability component have all kind of converged to really have a lot of popularity behind this style of food service. We like to say we utilize the assembly line format. Chipotle has certainly been a pioneer of that. I mean, there was even Subway back in the day.
The limited menu is like really the secret to our success of being able to, you know, master these recipes and turn out really, really great food.
There are loads of examples in the business world of somebody dares to do something first, and when they're successful, a lot of the companies jump on the boat and try to do some variation of that. I think if we were giving people more choices and creating a bigger market for what we have come to understand to be healthy food, that's going to be good for us as a country. Let's cook up some demand for salad greens and rice bowls. I think the more copycats, the better.
Yes, I'm crazy. I think all chefs are crazy. It wasn't what I expected. It was one of the hardest things I've done in my life.
Really?
Yes.
Describe the dish.
This is a rockfish taco.
Wow.
With a mango slaw and a lemon aioli.
At this point, I'm feeling confident.
Mm. It's got crunch. The season's beautifully done. It's not brilliant, but it's not bad. It's tasty. It's a three. Good job.
And I'm like, all right, I got this, because this is our first challenge. Now I know what's about to go down.
Hey, anytime, tonight.
Yes, Chef. Chef Ramsay keeps bugging me for these scallops. So if you want raw scallops, then that's what I'm going to send you.
When you get there that first day, they kill you.
Oh, look what he gave me. It's still moving.
Sorry, Chef.
I didn't see that part last night. In that situation, you being rushed, you don't have time to cook, the pan is not hot, he want raw scallop, and that's what I gave him. Get what you asked for.
You and the up upstairs. Get out!
I was embarrassed to go up first, and I was peed off.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 idiots.
That's disrespectful, right? That part was disrespect. Like, how you call 8 grown men idiots? Off screen, he's nice. He remembers everybody's name, family member name, what you like, what you don't like, and he try to motivate everybody. So he really cares about his craft, and he's not gonna let you go down. So he's a good guy.
By the time the average child graduates high school, they've eaten 1,500 peanut butter sandwiches. It's the second most popular sandwich ingredient in the United States, behind ham. But today, 400,000 kids in the U.S. are allergic to peanuts, a number that's tripled since 1997, and no one's quite sure why. Some schools are banning peanut butter entirely, and new spreads have made peanut butter alternatives a major industry in their own right. But how do they actually taste? We turn to the experts to find out.
It looks like Jif peanut butter.
I think there's a nut in here.
It smells like something I've had before.
It smells like nuts.
Nuts.
I can't really explain what it tastes like, but it's good.
It tastes like peanut butter.
That really tastes like peanut butter.
Well, it tastes a little like almond.
That was definitely almond.
But besides that, it's basically peanut butter.
It looks like Nutella.
It looks like fudge.
Sparkly, muddy sand.
Kind of sticky.
It definitely does not taste like chocolate fudge.
I don't like that.
Not so bad.
It tastes like some butter.
Does this have to do with sunflower seeds or something?
It's really sweet.
It tastes the best.
That's really sweet.
It tastes like something I've tasted before, but I forget what it's called.
I didn't taste anything in that one.
It tasted like nothing.
Nope.
It tastes like cashews to me.
Cashews?
That tastes really sweet.
Very sweet.
Sour.
I like that. You can see how some people might not like it though.
It looks like oatmeal.
Smells like wheat.
I'm kind of afraid to eat this one.
It tastes like...
Oh, no, that's walnuts.
Walnuts?
This is weird.
That tasted very weird. It had some ground up nuts that weren't fully grounded.
I didn't like that one, actually.
I did not like the walnuts.
This looks like baby food.
That looks like broth. Well, that's a lot of nuts.
Okay, I like it.
Macadamia?
It tasted like ham, and I am a pescatarian.
No.
I'm not tasting it again. I still don't like it.
Hi, I'm Joe Yonan, the food editor at the Washington Post, and I'm going to show you two tips for dealing with one of my favorite summer ingredients, corn. What you do is you wet the corn and then microwave it. After two and a half minutes, you can feel that it's loosened inside. It's hot, but I can still handle it carefully. And then I'm going to cut off one end, and you can see that it should not just come out, but come out very clean. Now for cutting the kernels off the cob. The problem is they tend to fly everywhere. So what I like to do is first cut the cob in half crosswise. Then they don't have as far to fall. And you've got kernels of corn.
There's lots of different hachapuris from Georgia, but this is the hachapuri hachuli. It's basically an open face hachapuri. Georgia, they use salguni cheese. We really can't get that version here because we don't have their cows or their soil. So we use a really good high-grade hard mozzarella with feta cheese and ricotta cheese. Our little spin on it, since our owner Rose is from Lebanon, we use a little bit of za'atar mix. The za'atar has a little sumac in it, has a little lemon flavor in it.
The squash blossom is subtle. By filling it with something, what you're doing is you're sort of taking advantage of this awesome structure that it has. I think the flavors are traditional. It's just that the taco itself is not something I've ever seen before.
Hi, I'm Joe Yonan. I'm the food editor at the Washington Post, and I am going to give you some great tips for storing, peeling, and seeding tomatoes. Let's start with storage. Store the tomatoes on the countertop, not in your refrigerator. In your refrigerator, they'll get mealy, the texture changes. If you store them on the countertop with the stem side down, it keeps them from ripening too quickly. What if you want them to ripen faster? Well, you just put them in a paper bag and you put a piece of fruit that's already ripe in there. I like to use a banana. And then make sure that you watch this very carefully. Check it multiple times a day. You don't want a rotten tomato. Next up is peeling, which some recipes really need you to do. I'm gonna show you how I like to do it. First, you lightly score it. Make a little X on the bottom opposite the stem end, and then put it scored side down in a small bowl. Then we're gonna pour boiling water over it from a tea kettle. So now you just wanna let it sit for 3 or 4 minutes just to let the water loosen the skin. So if the tomato is ripe enough, you should see after 3 or 4 minutes that the skin has started to loosen enough for you to be able to peel it. Next, seeding. Here's how you do it. First, you cut the tomato into quarters. Then you take each quarter and you just use your finger, pull out these gel packs, just scoop them out while leaving as much of the flesh of the tomato as possible.
The classic daiquiri cocktail. This was the favorite cocktail of John F. Kennedy, or one of his favorites. Now, the daiquiri is not the thing you think of when you go to New Orleans and you walk down Bourbon Street and you have one of those alcoholic Slurpees. The daiquiri is a classic drink made of just 3 ingredients, fresh lime juice, sugar, and a good rum. What you're gonna start with is just a half a lime. If you can cut a lime in half, you're halfway there. For the rum we're using this evening, this is from the Hemingway Rum Company. Ernest Hemingway, the famous author, his family has authorized the creation of a beautiful rum called Papa's Pilar from the Hemingway Rum Company. Then you add just a little bit of simple syrup, maybe about a half an ounce. That gives it a little bit of sweetness. So you have what you refer to as the classic trinity of strong, sweet, and sour. You're gonna add your ice to this. Now, John F. Kennedy was sipping on daiquiri cocktails that fateful evening of November 1960 when he discovered he'd won the election against Richard Nixon. It was now going to become the President of the United States. Daiquiri was one of his favorite drinks and one of my favorites as well. Cheers. Another drink we'll be doing this evening was a favorite drink of Franklin Delano Roosevelt, the 32nd President of the United States. His wife Eleanor said that people drank them with great zest because he had made them, but they were apparently pretty awful at times. Now the classic gin martini, and there really is only one martini, is made the way I like to make them, is about 2 to 1, maybe 2 ounces of good London dry gin. This is Citadel gin from France, a delightful gin. And we're using, also from France, a lovely the Dolin dry vermouth, maybe 1 ounce of that. This is how FDR might have made it. He had you can actually see his shaker up in Hyde Park on display. I'm gonna add a little bit of orange bitters from Fee Brothers of Rochester, New York. Orange bitters are delightful in a martini, just a couple of drops. And you wanna stir this. Now you can shake it, of course. James Bond, Ian Fleming, made very popular the idea of shaking a martini. It's all a matter of personal choice. And you can garnish this with a lemon peel, with an olive, with pickled okra, anything you like, but I'm gonna serve this without a garnish this evening. Cheers. We're gonna be doing a variation on the Manhattan this evening, created in honor of President McKinley's 1896 presidential bid called McKinley's Delight. After the invasion of Cuba, it also became known as the Remember the Maine. We're gonna start by chilling our glass again. We're gonna have 2 ounces of Bulleit rye whiskey. You can use bourbon or rye. I'm gonna use rye. And we're using the Italian style sweet vermouth of Dolan from House Alpens. And to make it a true cocktail, we need to add bitters. I'm using Fee Brothers whiskey barrel bitters, just a couple of dashes of the Fee Brothers. Add a little bit more ice to your mixing glass. You want to use very large ice cubes and plenty of it. You do want some dilution. but you want the drink to be as cold as it can be without being too watery. And now you have the classic Manhattan. You can garnish that with a Marasca cherry or with a lemon peel. Cheers.
It's the news few want to hear, a shortage of chocolate. But some of the world's biggest producers have warned it could run out by 2020. The reason? People are eating it faster than farmers can grow the key ingredient. Cocoa prices have surged 25% in the last year. That's partly down to economic and environmental pressures on farmers, and partly down to Asia, where demand has reportedly increased 7 times faster than in Europe. The trend has even increased in South America, where chocolate was invented. Brazil, once one of the world's biggest cocoa manufacturers, is now a net importer. Combine all this with fears about Ebola reaching key West African cocoa growers, and you have a problem. Paul Young is a master chocolatier in London.
For us, I think what will happen is if the bigger multinationals can't buy their cacao from West Africa, they'll start looking elsewhere, and that could be the places where I buy a lot of my cacao and chocolate from. Those places could then start to feel the pinch, so those prices could end up rising as well, which would then affect me directly and my customers.
Some producers are trying to get ahead of the game, investing in new cocoa markets like Colombia and Trinidad. But consumers may have to think about reducing their intake, or chocolate could become a rare luxury like caviar.
You can really use any kind of potato for mashed potatoes. I like Yukon Golds. It makes a creamy mashed potato, but you can also use a good old russet potato for something a little fluffier. This really helps season the potatoes, and then you don't have to add as much salt later. That'll come back to the boil. It'll cook about 10 to 20 minutes. For about 3 pounds of potatoes, I use about 1/2 cup of milk and 6 tablespoons of butter, and it's melting over medium heat. No resistance. I pull back the skewer, it comes right back. Yeah, and that's great. And I just want to dry them out. And what that does is it makes them extra fluffy and creamy because they're able to absorb the liquid that I put in them without watering it down. A ricer gives the potatoes a really beautiful, smooth fluffiness. And then really all I need to do is add this butter-milk combination. It smells so good. And all you have to do is stir. And those are the perfect mashed potatoes.
If you're having a lot of people and you're worried about cooking 2 big birds, I have a suggestion. Why don't you make 1 bird, but days ahead even, you could do a turkey breast. You could stuff a turkey breast. What I have here is a bone-in turkey breast, 7 or 8 pounds. It comes with one of these things, which you're going to take out right away. What I have done is I've lined my counter with plastic wrap, a couple of pieces, and that way I'm not going to get any turkey anywhere I don't want it to be. Down my breastbone. I'm going to start making a cut, and I want to try to keep the skin together with the flesh. I am going to make some cuts. You'll see it's falling right away very nicely. And that's about as far as I want to go on this side. I haven't left too much meat on the bone, and I see that turkey tenderloin. And then I'm just going to sort of cut it away. So these are my turkey tenderloins. So what could I do with those? I could save them for sandwiches, or stir fries. Want to get it free at this point from the bone. What this carcass can do is I can do two things. I can throw it in the oven with some herbs and spices, and I can roast it and use it for stock, or I can put it in a stock pot right now with some aromatics. And we are out. I want to get kind of a flat surface, so I might make a few shallow cuts. I cut a slice of this, and then I'll have a nice slice to make a sandwich with that's got the stuffing. All you need to do is add the cranberry sauce. So I've got everything I need here to make Pam the Butcher's roast turkey au jus. I have some herbs and an onion that's quartered for stuffing the turkey. I've got a mixture of salt, pepper, garlic powder, and dried sage. I've got water, celery, and about a 14-pound bird. It trusses the bird. It keeps the legs in so that the bird cooks nice and evenly. And you'll notice I don't have a rack there because we're going to be building a rack with the celery. Alrighty, I'm putting my bird on the celery rack. And then I'm going to season inside the cavity. Now I'm going to fill the cavity with a nice mixture of herbs. I'm going to add the onion. They don't really need to be very tightly packed in there. Now I'm going to season the outside of the bird with some of the spice mixture, kind of nice and evenly. The last thing I'm going to do is I'm going to pour enough water just to cover the celery. Into the oven, the big bird goes. It should really be in the middle of the oven, but depending on how tall your bird is, how big the breastbone is, you may need to drop that middle rack just down one peg. And for the next 2 hours, I'm going to be basting a total of 3 times with the mixture, the liquid that's mingling with the spices and the juices from the turkey. I'm going to be basting with that liquid inside the bird, inside the cavity, as well as on the bird's exterior. After the last baste, after maybe 10 minutes, I'm going to tip that bird just a little bit so that I get as much broth and liquid and juices out of the cavity at that point as I can. I'm looking for an internal temperature of 160 degrees. I'm gonna pull this bird out. I'm gonna let it sit for at least 15 or 20 minutes before I carve it up.
Don't worry about matching one wine to everything. Nothing's going to match all the turkey and the trimmings and, God forbid, the jellied cranberry sauce. Champagne or sparkling wine is the ultimate palate cleanser. The bubbles refresh your mouth and get you ready for the next bite. Try cider as your bubbly. Cider, of course, is traditional from colonial times. They're lower in alcohol, very refreshing. Pinot Noir is a Thanksgiving favorite, no matter where it's from. Try a fruity white, maybe a little bit off dry, a little bit of sweetness helps with the variety of flavors. For that big bold red with the roast turkey, I favor this Maryland Syrah from Black Ankle. When you get towards dessert, if you're having cheese or pumpkin pie, look for something sweeter. The wine should be sweeter than the dessert, generally. We have Petit Manseng from Virginia, which is great with cheeses, very fruity, very aromatic. And here's a late harvest Vinsanto style from Virginia that's just wonderful with pumpkin pie. Enjoy the feast, don't sweat the wine, just open one of everything.
Frying is a great technique for cooking all sorts of foods, but people are afraid of it. It's greasy, it's messy, but it doesn't have to be either of those things if you follow a few simple rules. I'm going to show you some tricks. So I like to use a vegetable oil, a neutral vegetable oil, like sunflower oil or safflower oil. So the key is to make sure that the oil gets up to 375 degrees. That way the food will crisp without absorbing it. So I thought we would try one of my favorite things of the season, fried green tomatoes. They're coated in a little panko flakes. Don't be afraid to get a little close to the oil when you drop them in, because that way it